Hello, I'm Tracy Smith, the president of Numerical Insights and the creator of the Business Survival with Analytics series. You can view all the videos in this series in any order you wish, so feel free to start with the one that helps you address your most urgent business problems. Today, I'd like to talk about improving your bottom line through an analysis of both product and customer profitability and the benefits of analyzing these together. If you're the owner of a business that carries a large number of parts or SKUs, it's difficult to keep on top of the performance of each individual item, especially as prices change or different customers have negotiated different pricing with you. How do you know if a product is profitable? How much does each product actually contribute to your bottom line? How do you know if you're losing money on some of your products? If you are, can you just stop offering these items? I'll show you how you can use business analytics to answer these questions. For this example, I have a data set which records each line item from customer purchases. I have the item number purchased, how many, who bought it, the unit cost, and the price at which it was sold. The profit of each line item has been calculated using the formula on the screen. For this exercise, we're using a simple profit calculation and not allocating any of the fixed costs or other internal company costs to this calculation. Taking those costs into account is activity-based costing, which is an accounting method that identifies the activities that a company performs and then assigns the cost of each of these activities to the products with which they are associated. What this data shows us is that this company serves multiple locations for customers, so we'll need to add the parent company to group those together. A parent company is the overall corporation which can consist of multiple sub-companies, brands, or locations. For example, PepsiCo is a corporation which owns Frito-Lay and other brands, and each of those brands has multiple locations. If you are shipping products to these locations, you may decide to group your data at the parent level to understand just how much of your profit comes from serving PepsiCo. If your data system allows you to record the name of the parent company and export it with your data set, it will save you a lot of work. I'll skip ahead to where I've already done that, and we now have parent company names installed. You can perform this analysis with Excel, Power BI, Tableau, whichever tool you choose. I'll show you this example in Excel. If I summarize my product data with Excel, I get the following. I've sorted our products in order of total profit. If we scroll to the bottom, you'll see that we definitely have some product offerings that are being sold at a loss. Let's focus on those since we'd like to find a way to stop our losses. While your first instinct might be to cancel the profit-losing SKUs, there can be several reasons why companies legitimately choose to keep selling products at a loss. Here are a few examples of why. It may be a loss leader to attract customers to other more profitable items. It may be a replacement part used to support a product warranty. For example, a manufacturer of car parts may be required to produce a warranty part for 7 to 10 years. It may have reached the end of its life cycle and the market price of the item has now dropped below the unit cost. For each loss item, it's important to know why it's still being produced and also who's currently buying it. If you were to suddenly stop producing a part that some of your best customers are buying, what would that do to your relationship with your best customers? You have to carefully plan the discontinuation of products or SKUs to ensure that the impact to your best customers is minimized. You should also check to see if any of these products are sold as a group with other products. In this case, you should calculate the profit of the group rather than the profit of the individual product components. So, we now need to know who the best customers are before we start making any product decisions. To do this, I've rolled up all the line item profit values by customer name and sorted them from largest to smallest. We can see that we have some customers at the bottom of the list that have a negative contribution to our company. I'll group these customers into three groups and label them A, B, and C. C group is all of the customers at the bottom of the list that show a negative total profit. Groups A and B are customers that have positive total profit. In this scenario, the A group generates the top 80% of that profit, and the B group generates the remaining 20% of that profit. This 80% value is not a randomly selected value. It's based on the 80-20 rule. This rule asserts that 80% of outcomes result from 20% of all causes or inputs. In business, the 80-20 rule is used to prioritize where we spend our efforts. In our example, the 80-20 rule asserts that 80% of our profit comes from 20% of our customers. While this 20% isn't exact in each analysis, the main interpretation is that not all of our customers are equally important to us. In most cases, a small number of customers provide most of our profit. Now that all of our customers have been categorized as an A, B, or C, we can look at our unprofitable products and see whether we're selling any of these to our A customers. We can see that we do have some of our best customers buying some of the lost parts. In this situation, the action to take is to go through each of those parts and work with the customer to see if some of your existing profitable parts can be used as a substitute to migrate away from the lost parts. For C customers who aren't contributing anything to our bottom line, it's easier to discontinue their ability to buy negative profit items. It can take substantial time to go through the list of unprofitable items to see who's ordering them and to decide what action to take regarding each item. But a systematic analysis is needed in order to minimize the impact to customers that do contribute to your bottom line. You may decide to discontinue the part, keep it as a loss leader, or possibly renegotiate the item price with your supplier. The end result of this analysis is that you can reduce the number of products or parts that you carry, which frees up cash flow that was tied up in inventory. There are additional benefits that come with this decision. I mentioned previously that the profit calculation used in this example did not include the allocation of fixed costs and other internal costs. Inside any company, there are people and systems that support the number of items you carry. In reducing the number of items, you may also have freed up some of the time employees were spending on supporting the original number of parts. They now have a few more hours per week to work on other activities. Additionally, you may wish to use the customer prioritization data to make a decision about how you support each of your customers. In some companies, the largest customers are assigned dedicated sales reps, and the smaller customers are served with a common call-in support service line. As you can see, analyzing your product and customer data together can help you make decisions about what to keep offering your customers and how to support them. If you enjoyed this video, feel free to press like and also subscribe to the channel to receive notification of new videos. You can also visit our website for more information on using data analysis to improve decision-making.